Thank you very much for the invitation, and thank you all of you for being here. I have been looking forward to this day for quite some time, not because I knew that someday I was going to be invited to speak at the SACNAS conference, but because I have been looking forward to the day of giving a talk in front of an audience of scientists who look like me and who may have a story similar to mine. I am an evolutionary biologist, and when I say this, some people imagine that I study something like this, or maybe this. But no, I don't study dinosaurs or the evolution of humans. I study something more amazing and beautiful. I study the evolution of plants. Plants are remarkable organisms. We see them every day and almost everywhere. But perhaps few people know or realize that plants have been on Earth for almost 500 million years. That plants produce most of the oxygen that we all breathe, and that the history of our own cultures is tightly linked to the use and domestication of some plants. Today, I will tell you three short stories that weave my research about plant evolution, my life, and us, the SACNAS community. The first story is about diversity, or biodiversity. Biodiversity simply means the different types of species or different types of organisms that we see in nature. If we look at a map of biodiversity, we see that biodiversity is not evenly distributed across the world, and that there are some regions, like the tropics, that have high levels of biodiversity for different groups. For example, plants, birds, mammals, insects. A key question in evolutionary biology that I'm interested is, how does this happen? Where does biodiversity come from? A useful framework to answer this question is by this hypothesis in biology that states that diversity begets diversity. And by this, I mean that there is a positive correlation between two ways to think about diversity. For example, we can think about places that have more species diversity for one group of species, and that stimulates the generation of species diversity in a different group. I have been lucky enough to be traveling the world to test these ideas. And for example, in the tropical Andes, I have been able to study how diversity of climates and the diversity of ecologies and the rugged topography of these places work as engines to promote the formation of new plant species. In the Amazon basin, I have been studying how the diversity of insects and the diversity of interactions between insects and plants drives the evolution of new plant species. My fascination with biodiversity clearly comes from my upbringing in Colombia and from being exposed to the amazing biodiversity of the tropics all my life. Colombia is also diverse culturally, and I am proud to say that I am the product of the exchange among those different cultures. I believe that this mix of cultures and the environments that I grew up in have given me a unique view of the world that illuminates my research on a daily basis. And here we are. We are all diverse. We have different backgrounds. We have different stories. We have different lived experiences. And I believe that this diversity is what makes us unique, what makes us special and important in science, because we bring diverse ideas, diverse perspectives, and diverse solutions to tackle some of the major scientific problems in our fields. Diversity begets diversity. The second story is about migration. Growing up in the Andes, a simple observation that you can make is that when you hike up a mountain, biodiversity changes as you go up. For example, you find only certain species in low elevations, and as you keep going up the mountain, this diversity changes. And this pattern is repeated across all the tropical mountains. A major question in biology is, how does this happen? Where do organisms come from and find the places where they can grow? One way to answer this question is provided by the hypothesis in biology that states that perhaps it's easier to move than to evolve. And by this, I mean that for some organisms, maybe it's easier to move and track the conditions where they can survive than trying to adapt and evolve to new conditions that they haven't experienced before. I have been studying this phenomenon across the world again with different plants and in different places. Recently, I tested this idea with tropical plants from mountains throughout the world. And I have been able to show that indeed, plants from tropical mountains are adapted to very narrow climatic conditions and that they disperse across these mountain ranges, finding those conditions instead of evolving adaptations to new conditions that they haven't experienced before. I have also moved. I migrated to the US to pursue grad school and then as a postdoc until I secured my position currently at UCLA. These migrations were key to my life and my career because I went to places that gave me the opportunity to thrive thanks to the support that I found in my mentors, in my PhD and as a postdoc, as well as the network of colleagues and friends who have supported me throughout my career. Migrating was the best thing that could have ever happened to me. And here we are again. We are all migrants in one way or another. Perhaps some of you are first-generation migrants like myself. For some of you, maybe it was your parents or your grandparents who migrated for different reasons. I believe that moving to new places, finding supportive mentors, and having a network like us, the SAGNAS community, is critical to our success. Don't be afraid to move. Go to where your heart and your passions are. Migration can help us grow. Sometimes it's easier to move than to evolve. The last story is about adaptation. Growing up in the tropics was also a great experience for me to witness different ecosystems with very different environments in which plants have adapted and have evolved unique adaptations to adapt to these extreme conditions. A fundamental question in biology is how do organisms do that? How do they evolve new adaptations? Perhaps an interesting way to answer this question is by flipping this hypothesis that I just presented before, and that for some organisms, maybe it's easier to evolve than to move and evolve new adapt to new conditions that they haven't experienced before. I have been studying this phenomenon in different places, with different plants as well. And more recently, I have been able to study the evolution and adaptations of cactus plants in the Galapagos Islands. The Galapagos Islands are relatively recent ecosystems in geological time, but they are extremely harsh ecosystems because they are volcanoes. By studying the ecological and the genomic basis of adaptations, we have been able to start to understand that the adaptations that these resilient plants have developed are tightly linked to their interactions with the finches that Charles Darwin himself studied to propose the theory of evolution by natural selection. I have also migrated and arrived to a new environment, a harsh environment where I did not belong, an environment where I am in the minority, but I have adapted to it and have succeeded. I believe that my background, my experiences, my diverse background have given me the resilience to adapt and thrive in this new environment and be a successful researcher today. And again, I believe that this is all of us. We may be minorities in STEM in the US, but we are majorities in our local communities. I believe that our diverse backgrounds and personal stories give us the resilience to make us strong, to survive, and to adapt to these academic environments where we are not the majority in the US, at least for now. In closing, I hope that we remember the importance of three ideas. That diversity is critical for science, that moving is an amazing learning experience, and that we are resilient to thrive in new environments. Thank you very much. That's-